So, while doing my daily research for tech rules can be exhausting at times, it also leads to some pretty fun rabbit holes. Sometimes I'll come across strange occurrences or questions that I just can't let go of until I find the answers to them. Case in point, why is my SEO tool telling me that a giant portion of my viewers are suddenly really, really interested in Mario Party DS? And then I realize, oh, okay, they're interested in the game's anti-piracy, which hit the YouTube algorithm this month. Which brought me to my second question, wait, what? Because, that game doesn't have anti-piracy measures, to my knowledge. And trust me, I spend way too much time looking into anti-piracy. Turns out, someone made a really impressive mock-up of a genuinely creepy anti-piracy screen that Mario Party DS would have. And it made me remember how interested people are in scary or otherwise creepy anti-piracy measures. Which, you know, I get it. It's a very creepypasta-esque scenario when the game itself can tell that it was stolen and choose to mess with you. But because of that, there seems to be a lot of misinformation on what measures are actually real. To the point where many fakes are just so widely accepted to be real that nobody ever questions the legitimacy of them. Like, I feel like I can just go around saying that Among Us has anti-piracy, where you're put in pirate-only lobbies where everyone is a crewmate and everyone just kills each other out of unfounded paranoia, and it genuinely feels like a significant amount of people would believe me. That aside, that's a killer idea. Among Us devs, hit me up on Twitter, let's talk. But seriously, it's that bad. So I thought, why not use my weird obsession and knowledge of anti-piracy measures to not only clear up which anti-piracy measures are clearly fake, but actually show you lesser known real examples that I find much, much more upsetting. Plus, I don't know, you all seem at least slightly interested in me talking about anti-piracy, huh? Well, I guess we're about to find out. Welcome to Tech Rules. But first, a huge thanks to Blinkist for sponsoring today's video. Living in the age of information can be both a blessing and a curse. Sure, we have all this information at our fingertips, but not all of it is productive, and it's often hard to find useful, worthwhile information to improve yourself when it's buried under social media, games designed to take your time, and countless other distractions that are in our face 24/7. Blinkist is the app that's here to help with that. They've taken thousands of amazing, helpful nonfiction books and condensed them to just 15 minutes of pure, concentrated content that gives you the best of what the content has to offer. Making time to read a book? That's hard. But finding 15 minutes for Blinkist? Not so much. Whether you're reading them yourself or taking advantage of the podcast-style feature to listen to it, you can squeeze some productivity into your day at every corner. Not to mention, you can access them offline, so there's no need to worry about spotty connection ruining your plans. If you need a place to get started, allow me to recommend this book, Valley of Genius, which goes over the history of Silicon Valley and how it became what it is today. It's a 16-minute read of pure history and technology goodness. Not unlike a Tech Rules video. So give it a shot. The first 100 people to go to my link below, blinkist.com/techrules, will get an unlimited access free trial for 1 week. It's free, you can cancel anytime, and you'll also get 25% off if you decide you want the full membership. So act fast and take the first step to optimizing your reading. Anyway, on to the video. First of all, I just want to point out that if you're interested in any of the anti-piracy measures I go over in this video and you want to learn more about them, the best place to go would be the cutting room floor. It's one of the biggest resources I've used for I don't know how many years to quickly find out interesting behind-the-scenes stuff for my favorite games. In fact, most of the information I'm about to give you I probably learned straight from that website. Also, because of the nature of the video, I'm going to be going over a lot of videos of a lot of games, most of which I couldn't realistically capture footage for. So today, we'll be relying on old YouTube videos. In these cases, you'll find the channels the video came from in the corner of the screen, and in the description you'll find direct links to these videos. I'd love to get permission directly from everyone in this list, but most of these channels were made in the late 2000s and aren't active today. If you're in this video and you don't like it, send me an email, I'll take care of it. I also want to avoid talking about examples that have already been done to death. Yeah, Earthbound crashes and deletes your save file at the end of the game. GTA 4 turns you into a dangerous alcoholic with an unstoppable need for speed. Game Dev Tycoon kills your business because of the very crime you committed. These are all really interesting examples, but every YouTuber and their mother has talked about it, and I'd rather tell you about stuff that you've hopefully never heard of before. We're also not gonna go over feelies because they're not terribly... No, I should probably talk about them really quickly. Essentially, back in the days of DOS, software anti-piracy measures were bare bones and oftentimes non-existent. And that's why feelies exist, a nickname for these little plastic things that would be included with your game disc. These things typically work in a weird way that makes copying the information really difficult. For example, Dial a Pirate, the feelie introduced with The Secret of Monkey Island. When the game booted up, it would show you an ugly amalgamation of two pirate heads merged together and ask for a code. All you would have to do is recreate the freak of nature on your wheel and input the code that appears below it. This is required. You lose the wheel, you lose the game. Code wheels like this were a common form of feelies. I'd love to go more in depth about these kinds of anti-pirate... No, I wouldn't, actually, that was a lie. They're neat, but again, talk to death. Moving on. Speaking of talk to death, that includes a lot of anti-piracy measures that aren't even real. And I'm not talking about the ones that are just fun little what-ifs like Mario Party DS and Mario 64, although those do seem to have a similar theme. Well, as long as you consider weirdly aggressive and creepy a theme. In fact, it seems that anti-piracy itself has developed strong association with creepy and disturbing imagery these days. Well, I say these days, but kids growing up always thought anti-piracy was creepy. If you were- okay, I'm gonna break my no popular examples rule for a second because I want to explain why people found anti-piracy so, like, traumatizing. If you were unfortunate enough to be a kid in the Super Nintendo era who didn't take good care of their games, you might have accidentally triggered one of the anti-piracy screens from a first-party Nintendo title, such as Super Mario All-Stars, Super Metroid, or like Super Punch-Out, you know, as the era of Super games. If one of these games decided they were being played on some sort of copier, it would pop up a black screen with no music and say something about how it's a serious crime to copy video games. If you're a kid just trying to play Mario and the game suddenly mentions a serious crime, you're probably gonna be a little upset. That being said, I'm not exactly sure how these screens would be triggered so easily. The game checks for a copier by saving data to an address in SRAM, the place where the game saves data, that shouldn't normally exist, because the SRAM for the game simply isn't that large. If it actually succeeds, that typically means the game is running on some sort of copying device like a super wildcard or something, that pretty much always defaults to a large SRAM size, and it isn't legitimate. So for this to actually trigger on normal hardware, something has to be going really, really wrong. I've always wondered if people actually saw these screens as a kid, or if people in the YouTube comments for the screens were just lying for no reason, as YouTube commenters tend to do. That would have to be a lot of liars, though, so I feel pretty confident in assuming it was an actual thing that could happen. If it happened to any of you, without any cheating devices or copiers or anything like that, please say something in the comments. Oh, and don't lie. Or like, lie in an extremely obvious fashion so I'm not confused. Point being, making a good imitation of this involves towing the line between practicality and creepiness. Maybe you can get away with upping the creepy factor a little, after all it won't be nearly as scary now that they're not kids anymore. But that probably doesn't say much, since it seems most kids were afraid of playing Lego Island without the CD and hearing the funny Lego man go, "Whoops!" However, some popular anti-piracy myths just go completely off the deep end. Take, for example, Cuphead. From what I've heard, it goes something like this. If you pirate the game, you'll hear a creepy, demonic, reversed version of the title screen that'll continue to play throughout the game, along with a bunch of other gameplay effects that are different depending on who's telling the story, but rest assured, they're all very, very spooky. Yeah, this one's not real. This myth got started because of the unused audio file that was silently introduced in one of the game's updates, it seems. Or it might have been there the entire time, I don't know. To the story's credit, it is the aforementioned reverse audio file with a bunch of weird noises in it. What's more, it's titled Muse Intro Don't Deal With Devil Vocal 666. And if you open it in a spectrogram tool, spectrogram, is that how you say it? You can see some really cool spectrograms it makes with the devil from the final boss fight. That being said, the story ends there. It's just a cool little thing they added in, and it seems the anti-piracy thing was a rumor that went too far. I'd typically just leave it there, but I know people are gonna be yelling at me like, no, tech rules, you just didn't look hard enough. How could you possibly, like, okay, first of all, Cuphead's DRM free, you can buy it on GOG. Second of all, if something like that existed, someone would have found a way to trigger it by now, but we don't have a way to trigger it because it's not real. Any video footage you find of it is also probably just a mock-up unless they specifically say how to trigger it. Oh, and another big one, Five Nights at Freddy's, you cannot forget that one. There are a thousand different variations of this one, but the main one is that the game plays completely normally until you try to exit the game, at which point it jump scares you and then exits normally. So the only punishment is scaring you in a horror game. Despite the fact that it doesn't make any sense, you can find information about this supposed anti-piracy screen on Wikipedia, news articles, videos from otherwise trustworthy sources, it's everywhere. And no, I have decompiled this game for the Ruining FNAF video. I literally know nearly everything about how this game works. It doesn't have anti-piracy. The normal Freddy jump scare frames aren't even loaded in on the main menu. What people are describing isn't possible. And you can be like, okay, well, what if the developers made their own torrent for the game and only those versions have those screens like Game Dev Tycoon did? Yeah, you're right. They could have done that. But they didn't. There are no known torrents for any of these games that do the things people are describing. Like, hear me out on this. The point of anti-piracy is, like, to stop you from pirating the game. If these little creepypasta stories are real, what point would that serve? To scare the pirate? Why? What does that do? Haha, now they're scared and they'll never play the game. What does that do? I'm not trying to beat a dead horse here or act surprised that misinformation exists on the internet, but a lot of this stuff is treated like common knowledge. It just baffles me. I feel like someone's grandparent yelling at kids on my lawn that you can't unlock Luigi in Mario 64. Tech rules, official party pooper. However, there have been times where a much more interesting scenario has occurred. Ones where fake anti-piracy screens got spread around because there was actual evidence they existed. That's probably a really strange sentence, so let me give you an example. If you've looked into Easter eggs and stuff like that for Pokemon Fire Red, you've probably heard of the anti-piracy message that occurs in Vermilion City when trying to take the ferry. The message simply reads, "By the way, if you like this game, buy it or die." As you would probably expect, this one also isn't real. But the weird part about this one is the amount of people who claim to see it for themselves was way too high compared to your typical video game myth. Countless people have claimed over the years that they've seen this screen with their very own eyes, and some even went as far as to claim that it happened on their legitimate copies while messing around with a cheat device. So, what's the deal? Does the message actually exist? Of course not. One look at the game in a hex editor shows that the text simply doesn't exist, and if you're familiar with how the game works, you can take that one step farther and prove that it can't exist by examining the script itself. That means that if this wasn't just a case of mass lying and people really were experiencing it, the only possible explanation would be ROM hacks. And that's exactly what it was. There is exactly one known original dump of this game that has this dialogue in it. I hunted it down, and sure enough, it's there. The line's conveniently placed just before a whole bunch of unused data, so it was clearly added in secret by whoever dumped this ROM. To be fair, this one isn't nearly as widely spread as the FNAF or Cuphead one. You won't find it in any otherwise factual write-up about the game. I think the only reason it got as far as it did is because, as the story goes, the game's original dumpers were asked to verify it was in the game, to which they confirmed, yeah, it is. Which, that's either a twisted version of what actually happened, or just made up entirely, because it doesn't exist in good dumps of the game. However, it was still prevalent enough that it still trips up otherwise good YouTubers from time to time. However, there is one popular anti-piracy myth I can confirm to actually be true, and that's Baldi's Basics. Namely, the exclusive Kickstarter demo for Baldi's Basics Plus. If the anti-piracy is triggered, the game will refuse to play normally and instead show this unsettling image, well, okay, unsettling for its edutainment atmosphere, with creepy music in the background saying, "Something doesn't add up," and telling you to refer to the instruction booklet for more information. This is actually a reference to what might be the most popular anti-piracy screen on the SNES, which is the one for Donkey Kong Country 2. Instead of just showing a blank or otherwise uninteresting screen like the games I talked about earlier, it shows Diddy and Dixie Kong in jail. Granted, this is just the game over screen from normal gameplay, and Donkey Kong Country 3 does the same thing, but this one happens to convey a very strong message. Diddy Kong is in jail because he pirated a video game, and you will be too. Now, whether or not this was intentional is another story, but frankly, I just wish they did the same for the first Donkey Kong Country. That one just used a generic blue screen, but imagine if the game used its game over screen. That would be a much more interesting message. Nintendo's showing you what happens to pirates. That might be the least intimidating noise I've ever made. Also, the Baldi's Basics Plus anti-piracy actually has a lot to it, so I might talk more about that in a dedicated video if that's what people want to see. But that's something for the future, because I feel like if I delay the FNAF 2 video much longer, people are gonna start getting a little violent. But I'm gonna be honest with you. Most implementations of anti-piracy aren't nearly as interesting as these. While some of them are funny, like the chicken thing I mentioned in a previous video, most of them are actually designed to be indistinguishable from a random crash or so subtle that you don't really notice it until it suddenly impedes game progress. This follows the same philosophy we talked about in the Spyro video. Anti-piracy only delays the inevitable, so tricking the scene into thinking they successfully cracked the game is a very effective method of buying just a bit more time. This also happens to be the philosophy used to counter bootlegs in the arcade era. Most arcade games would verify their integrity by comparing it to a checksum. A checksum, without going too in-depth for the sake of this video, just means it's generating a small string that would always be the same as long as the files stay the same. If the bootlegger changes the files, the checksum would be generated as something different than what it's supposed to be, and it would detect that something's up. Typically, the actual effects were just the same as your average anti-piracy, just crash or break in some subtle way, like Puyo Puyo 2. The bootleg detection would actually disable the sending of garbage in that game. Garbage is the one and only method of attack in Puyo, so disabling this just meant that both players would essentially play forever with no way to triumph over the other. But that's not just an anti-piracy thing, it's a data thing. Checksums are just really useful. And sometimes even console games used it as some sort of anti-piracy check, a corruption check, even as an anti-cheating measure. And then there's Indiana Jones, The Last Crusade for NES. The Taito version, not the Ubisoft version, because of course there are two games for the same movie on the same console. If the checksum doesn't match in that game, you get an otherwise unused screen of Indy saying, "You got a checksum error today, but that doesn't mean you have to like it." Which, Okay. I mean, it does make the game unplayable, so I guess it could kind of be an anti-piracy or an anti-cheat thing or whatever. I don't know. It's just, it's weird. Don't quote a movie at me to tell me something's wrong that's weird.
Obi-Wan never told you it is a serious crime to copy video games.
No, if you want an example of how your average anti-piracy mechanic actually looks, you can look no further than a large portion of the DS game library. See, the DS kind of had a piracy problem due to the existence of flashcards. They ran completely fine on an unmodified DS and could run whatever game you wanted from removable storage, such as microSD. And since firmware upgrades weren't a thing on the DS, the only way to combat this was by implementing anti-piracy in the games themselves. Just to go over a few I remember, Bowser's Inside Story locked up at the file selection screen, Chrono Trigger locked up the first time you tried to time travel, Pokemon Black and White disabled EXP gain, Crystal Chronicles Ring of Fate would straight up stop your gameplay after enough time with a little thanks for playing screen, and so on. Although if you're looking for something more significant, I can think of a couple that were pretty funny. There's Gyakuten Kenji 2, commonly localized as Ace Attorney Investigations 2, that one changed the language of the game to Borginian, a made-up language from the Ace Attorney series, and since that game's basically a visual novel, you're probably not gonna enjoy it too much. Oh, and Michael Jackson The Experience, it's a clone of the Owendon series of rhythm games, so music is a big part of it. But you won't get to hear the music if the anti-piracy kicks in, because the game will lock up and start playing these really loud. Of course, that doesn't mean it's always so boring. If you're looking for a real anti-piracy implementation that actually is supposed to be scary, might I show you a game called La Abadia del Crimen? Please don't make fun of me for how I pronounce that. I can barely speak English. This one used to be obscure, but less so now that it seems YouTubers finally found it and talked about it. Which is great, because this one's pretty creepy. Basically, at one point while playing a pirated version of the game, instead of the usual snippet of Ave Maria playing in the background, you'll hear this. Once the audio clip is done, the screen will go black and the game will become unresponsive. Other than that though, I can't really think of any other anti-piracy measures that went out of their way to scare the player. Devs are trying to protect sales, not traumatize people. That being said, a very common trend with anti-piracy is unfortunately a different kind of scary. One where the anti-piracy program itself will crash, slow down, or otherwise damage your machine, although this typically happened because of careless and overly aggressive implementations rather than outright maliciousness. An example of this would probably be the old DRM implementation Star Force, although that's a whole topic for another day. But I can think of one game that's sort of malicious called Robbie Reeby. I would love to tell you about this game, but I don't really know anything about it. No. I saw it at AGDQ once, and I remember the runner said that the game was fun, so it's probably fun. However, the big reason I'm familiar with it is because of a sort of hidden DLC it has. Many games on Steam and similar services have the game's DLC come with the base download, and you have to unlock it by purchasing it in the store. This is common in stuff like fighting games, where you have to have all the characters for online matches even if you don't own them. However, there are programs out there that manually unlock these kinds of DLC even if you don't own it, which is very common with Steam emulators used to easily pirate Steam games. That's why Robbie Reeby has a hidden, fake DLC that you can't buy, but an emulator might unlock it by default. And if it does, level 1 will begin by opening the game's Steam page in your browser. This wouldn't be so bad if, it didn't happen every single frame. If your browser doesn't stop this from happening, you'll be flooded with web pages in seconds, and your computer will probably not handle it very well. However, looking back, I think my favorite anti-piracy screens from games weren't the ones that are scary or frustrating or even sneaky. It's the ones where someone, typically a developer of the game, just, you know, talks to the player. Reminds them that they need the profit to continue making games, and saying that if you can't pay, help in other ways, like spreading the word or getting others to buy it. I don't know, it's just nice that even with such a controversial topic, there are developers that just want to reach out and talk. I think I'll just end this video by showing you my current favorite anti-piracy measure of all time. One that you may have seen, actually. The anti-piracy dialogue from the rhythm game Just Shapes and Beats. But hopefully, this anti-piracy discussion was interesting to you in some way. Thanks for watching, and as always, I hope you keep an eye out for more tech rules.
Downloading pirated games is stealing! Stealing is against the law!
Hey there, Lash here. I just wanted to say that it's okay, I'm not mad. I've played my share of pirated game when I was a kid, so I guess this is karma, right? I remember when I was a kid, I didn't have any money to support my favorite developer. So I just wanted to say, if you cannot support the game devs with money, you can support them with words. You can talk about them, share the games with everyone, leave a positive review, a good rating, send them a tweet, an email, whatever. Let other people know. That helps us a lot. After all, if some people knows about the game, some of them will have money and buy it. In the end, we just want to be able to create more games. So I hope you had a good time with our game and say good things about it on internet. In the meantime, you can come chat with us live on berserk.tv if you're interested to see how games are made. So thanks for playing our games, it really appreciated. You're the best, bye!